Hello everyone, my intrepid band of OSATers, and welcome to this, the 15th episode of my podcast. I am Sockmatician, also known as Nathan Taylor, and you can find me on Instagram, Ravelry, Twitter, and here on YouTube as Sockmatician. Welcome back. It's been, golly, I think it's been over 3 weeks since my last episode, and I've been a busy boy, as always, and we'll talk about more about that in a moment, but I'm just so pleased to be back recording again. It's felt like too long, and I've really missed it. I've missed engaging with people. I've really missed being able to spend time on Instagram and on Twitter the way I'm used to doing, and I haven't been popping into my Ravelry group as much. Now, that's something I want to change, but life is really chaotic at the moment, as it always is. There's no point whinging about it, it's all good. I'd like to sort of address the balance of work and leisure at the moment, and there's a lot of work going on and a lot less leisure. And that's largely because of the scale of the big secret project, which I still can't talk about. Hopefully, in another 4 weeks or so, there'll be a big announcement and I'll be able to talk about it and tell you exactly what's been going on. But suffice to say, It's been a really stressful time, and not all of it in such a good way. Ben and I have had a lot of problems with just working out the parameters of what this project actually involves and trying to marry that with what the broadcasters want and what the production company want. And there's been a lot of sort of banging of heads together, and it's not been a great deal of fun. We've turned a corner, I think. We're all sort of on the same page again now, and hopefully things will get much better in terms of just smoothly being able to get through it. It has to be smooth. It's going to be a difficult achievement to pull it all off. There's a lot of different elements to it, and we just can't afford the time for there to be fighting and factions within everything. So in order to get the job done in the time we've got, which isn't very much time and a lot of work, we just need to all pull together, and I think we're going to be doing that from now on. So with a bit of luck and with a lot of contract wrangling and all that kind of nonsense, all the less fun stuff dealing with legal teams and making sure everything gets written out properly so we can all be contracted to do the things we need to do and not tread on anyone else's toes, and it's complex. You don't need to know about all that. But I'm hoping, I'm really, really hoping things will improve, because Ben and I have, we've not been sleeping a great deal. We've had a lot going on our minds. There's always busy head. And that, of course, makes us a bit more stressed, a bit more crabby the next day, which is not very helpful to anyone. So how are you? I have to say, I'm struggling a little bit today. This is the first time I've shot one of my podcasts on this, my brand new phone. I have the iPhone 6S. I love it. I went from an iPhone 5 straight to a 6S, and it's brilliant, but because of the configuration of where the buttons are, I've had to spin the phone round on my little tripod thing that I've got here set up, because otherwise the buttons get in the way and it wouldn't record. So now I've got to make sure, usually I'd look over there and that's where the camera would be, but today you're over there. And I've got to get used to that. I'm also having to get used to this rather unflattering lighting. I'm not really enjoying that. Ben and I were doing some filming this morning. The camera crew came round here to our house, and we've been filming in our kitchen and upstairs in our attic, which is where we do quite a lot of our work. And that took up quite a large portion of the day, when I was hoping to get round to doing this recording much, much sooner. So I'm a little bit late, losing the light. It's now sort of already 20 past five and the light is going. It's been a lovely autumny day. It's the 20th of October, if anyone cares, 2015. And so by the time we'd cleared out the camera crew and then went down to the cafe, which is sort of downstairs and a few doors that way, to get some lunch because we were starving by then, and got back and mopped up a little bit of admin. It's just like, gosh, it's 20 past five, and it takes me a while to set up to get a podcast going. I've got to gather all the bits and pieces that I want to talk about and make sure I don't have things primed on my iPad ready. It's a lot of prep. But you know that. Anyone who has watched a podcast knows that they don't happen by accident. Although maybe. Now here's the thing. Some people, it does look like it just all kind of happens naturally for them. And I'm wondering if that's because they're exceptionally well prepared, or whether in fact it's just completely off the cuff and it just comes naturally to them. Well, it doesn't come naturally to this podcaster. you'll have noticed, avid watchers, that I've sort of cut back on the level of editing that I've been doing. Now, that's something I do want to get back to doing and sort of upping everything. There will be some editing on this one, I know, because there's some photographs I want to edit in to show you from some of the things Ben and I have been up to over the last few weeks. But it's so time consuming, and sometimes when I've got a really long episode, something's like, I don't know, hour and a half of this, it's at least 3 hours to edit that, and then the time to upload it. I've said all this kind of stuff before, and I really don't want to sound like I'm whinging, because I'm really not. I very much enjoy what I'm doing. I wouldn't be doing this. However, I don't want people to think that I'm stopping caring about it. It's because I do care and I want to do it well that I'm frustrated at the moment because I don't have very much time. And when I started doing this, it was easy for me to take a whole day and record in the morning and spend the afternoon editing and do all that. I don't have that luxury at the moment, and might not again until February when this crazy project is over. So it's tricky to try and fit it in. That's all. It's a time management thing. It's not that I don't want to do it. It's that I want to do it really well. So yeah, that's been today. And I should mention hello to my dad. Hello, Daddy, who I now know watches this, thanks to Ben. Ben, you may not know. You may know this. I'm going to reciprocate now. Ben writes a daily blog, and it's called peepsmotet.blogspot.com. Peeps as in Samuel Pepys, P-E-P-Y-S. peepsmotet.blogspot.com. And he writes it every single day. And he has done since the 1st of January 2010. So we're well into the fifth year of that now. And it is every single day. And the reason why it's Peeps Motet, and the reason why he writes a blog, is we were, back then, he was trying to raise money to write and get performed a 40-part motet. A motet is a choral work, a piece of singing with no accompaniment. And 40 parts is a lot of different people singing a lot of different things all at the same time. And because 2010 was the 350th anniversary of the first entry in the diary of Samuel Pepys, the very famous diary, which you can see all the volumes here on my mantelpiece, Ben wanted to set passages of that to music. And he created this piece, and it is unbelievably complex musically, but brilliant, absolutely brilliant. It's a work of art. Some friends of mine had said, you know, why don't you set up a blog? Why don't you document what you're doing, or the journey to bringing the project to fruition? Because a blog is, of course, a modern day version of what Samuel Pepys was doing back along, which was the diary. And it seemed like a great idea. And a lot of people got on board, and we managed to raise the money, and it was great, and the project came off. And we've just recently recorded a 20-part reduction of it. 40 parts, it's a lot of people, a lot of work. It's going to be much more performable as a 20-part piece. So Ben's kind of restructured it, and we've recorded the 20-parter, and that is all done. We've got the CDs all boxed up in the loft, ready for release next year. I think we're going to be doing it next year now to coincide with the 350th anniversary of the Great Fire of London, which Pepys talks about and features prominently in the piece. So if you go to peepsmotet.blogspot.com, you will find Ben's daily entries. And he writes about what we're doing. Obviously, it's difficult for him at the moment because he also can't talk about the secret project. And some days, that's all we do. So very little left for him to write about. But he mentioned on his blog, that's the point of this rather convoluted story, he mentioned that that I have this podcast. Now, my family are avid readers of Ben's blog. This is brilliant and very supportive of them, but I am also very aware that it leaves me with nothing to tell my family anymore. If we've been away, if we've done something exciting, I'll phone my mum and I'll say, you'll never guess what... Oh, I know, I read about it on the blog! Like, great. Thanks, Ben. Thanks. So I never get to break any news to my family anymore. So, except what I had never told them about was this podcast. And I just hadn't come up. The knitting side of my life is it's kind of a new thing. And it's becoming quite a big part of my life, as is this. But it was just sort of happening and ticking over, and I hadn't got round to talking about it. So when Ben posted it, I was like, oh, there we go. It's like that moment when your mum requests your Facebook friendship. And you think, I can't really say no, but I might have to go in and tidy up some photographs. I remember that day. Thankfully, I've always been quite social media savvy, and I've never, because I, as an actor, I work a bit in the public eye, I've never posted anything that I'm not 100% willing to stand by or be proud of. That's not to say that I'm censoring myself and only putting out the public side of Nathan Taylor, but I'm just aware that I wouldn't want stuff like that to bite me on the bum. And it became really important when we were doing the wedding and things like that, because there was quite a lot of attention on us. I've always been quite used to it. And that the same is true for this. I've never said anything about my family that I wouldn't want them to hear. But I now know that my dad is watching, so hello. And I saw my family. Do you know what? I'm going to go straight in. Here's the roundup. And so since I last saw you guys, I've been, as I say, very, very busy. And there's some several bits and pieces that I want to share with you now. We have a very good friend, my friend Tobias, who comes from Brazil. Now, he's been in the UK for a lot longer than he was ever in Brazil. He's been here for 30 years this year, and he wanted to celebrate that. So he and his partner, Mark, hired a fantastic Tudor mansion house in Devon, sort of kind of a little bit west of Dartmoor, and near Bodmin Moor. And it's called Wortham Manor. And it's just amazing. I mean, I think it was built in 1500, or completed or started, so around the turn of the 16th century. And it's so wonderful. Bits of it have been modernised. It's very much a house you can stay in, and it's got decent bathrooms, and it's well heated and stuff. But there's so many original features. It's really, really quite beautiful. And so there were 13, I think, for dinner. That was a dangerous choice. But there were, I think, 13 of us staying there. Tobias and Mark had been there for all the week, and people sort of arrived at various nights throughout the week, ready for the big banquet in the Great Hall. Now, the Great Hall was stunning. When we first arrived at Wortham Manor, it was the... That is a motorbike. That's not the beans I had for lunch. When we first arrived at Wortham Manor, we went in via the Great Hall, and you walk in and this flagstone floor, big high ceiling. At one end there's this massive carved black wooden fireplace. That's another room completely. I'm describing something else. The fireplace is on the side wall, massive great big long table running down the middle with two throne-like chairs at either end. It's just stunning. So Tobias had requested that we all go fancy dress, Tudor fancy dress, for the banquet on the Saturday night. And they'd brought caterers in, and it was, you know, we had waiting staff. It was really done very, very properly. It was a big special event. And I could tell how excited Tobias was about it all. And it was just brilliant to be there. So Ben and I went to Angel's Costumiers, fancy dress hire shop. But they're also a theatrical costumiers, so they've got, I think, hundreds of thousands of articles of clothing in a massive warehouse, but they've got some that they keep in central London. And we went there and we looked at their Tudor section and found some amazing costumes. It's a little bit pricey. For the week it was £96 each costume. But they were really, really well made. They were clearly from some kind of Shakespearean production, possibly at the National, possibly at the RSC. and were great and fit as well. Actually, my trousers didn't fit. I had to get taken in, not taken out, thank you, taken in, because they were a bit big on me. So they did those alterations on the spot. Very good service. Had a nice lady coming round and saying, oh, actually, you'd wear this kind of boots with that, or this hat would go very well with that costume. It's the right period. Stuff that I just wouldn't know. And Ben looked fabulous with his little sort of velvet hat and his big, long velvet sort of long frock coat with little black leggings and some like slipper-like Elizabethan shoes. Really, really great. And we had a lovely time. There were people from, at the weekend, we had people from New Zealand, from Spain, from Texas, from the UK, from Brazil. Where else did people come from? All over. I mean, really, we're a very, very international bunch. And a very silly, and Scotland, very silly and wonderful time was had by all. One of the things we did while we were there, is we went off on a little day trip, and we went to Launceston. Now, Launceston is in Cornwall, and actually, do you know what? Before we went to Launceston, I've got to backtrack, we went to Tintagel, which is all wrapped up with the legend of King Arthur. And Tintagel is on the North Cornwall coast, and it's the land comes to a little promontory, and then there's a little spit of land, and then a little headland separate, which you can only get to via a bridge or a causeway. If you've ever seen the Roald Dahl film The Witches, the hotel that the grand gathering of the witches was held in, that was shot at a hotel that's just on the cliff at Tintagel. And I took a few photographs of it. If I can find one, you'll see one here. If not, I'm just pointing at empty air. And it's very recognisable. But that's not part of the Tintagel mystery. It's wonderful. There's this fantastic beach there with this beautiful waterfall jetting down, sort of maybe a 80, 90 feet high onto the beach. There's at the other end of the little beach, there's this cave that goes right through and out to the other side. So almost through this promontory of land, and you could walk through if the tide were properly out, but the water was in and we didn't want to get stranded inside this cave, which would not have been much fun. What else did we do while there? You walk up, oh my goodness, the steps. It was really, really tough. They were really, really very steep. And although we were all quite intrepid and doing it, we were properly winded by the time we got to the top. And it's the ruins of Tintagel Castle there, which was, it seems, I don't know much about it. Now, if I were Dan Jones, I'd have all of this information at my fingertips and I would know exactly what to say to you all. But it seems that the castle was built there. Oh, do you know what? I'm muddling it all up. I think in about the 12th century. Do you know what? Google Tintagel Castle. You'll find out all about it. It'll be lovely. It's a ruin. I mean, there's not much of it left, but there's foundations and there's the sort of the structure of it. It's fascinating. Then we went into Launceston. Launceston also has a castle, a Mott and Bailey castle, with a sort of big tower, round tower, circled by more stone, and which didn't seem to be built as a properly defensive site. From what I can gather, it seemed like it was more built as a bit of a show-off. It must have been quite an impressive castle when it was first built. And it wasn't a residential castle all the time, so usually it was just inhabited by the stewards and the staff. I don't know, that's the fact. And while we were in Launceston, there was a market. And one of the things I want to come on to is because there were two stalls at the market that were selling things which I think my knitting crew, my fellow band of O-Satters, might find interesting. And I wanted to share some of their stuff. So the first thing, now it's kind of, I haven't really planned this one as well as I have in the past, so the categories might also kind of cross over. But, because this is going to come into some stash enhancement, because I bought some while I was there. So now, you're going to get some stash enhancement. I went to a little stall, and I could see some hand-knitted goods. And they were all alpaca. And I was wearing an alpaca scarf of my own knitting. And I went over, and I was chatting to the lady, and I was saying, how do you know already? I said, alpaca is absolutely one of my favourite fibres. I love working with it. I love the feel of it in my fingers, that lovely kind of, it feels oily, but it's not. And And she was discussing this, actually. We were talking about how there's no lanolin in alpaca. And I've got, I may have mentioned this before, but I've got a big bag of alpaca fleece, which I've been putting off doing anything with because I couldn't be bothered to wash it. I don't think I need to. I've spoken to a couple of spinners, and they said with alpaca, you can just spin it straight off. You don't really need to comb it because the fibres are so sort of airy. And so I might just jump right in and start spinning it. You never know. You heard it here first. Anyway, got talking to this lady, and she knits quite a lot of the things that are there for sale, but they also sell alpaca yarn. She owns the alpaca farm, and it's called Over Priestercott Farm. Over Priestercott Farm, there. And I'm assuming that the lady I was talking to was Margaret of Rob and Margaret, as you can see there on the card. Rob and Margaret Hiscock. But they had some really, really lovely yarn. I thought, well, do you know what? I really like alpaca. I'm having a really lovely holiday. It's right here. It would sort of be churlish of me not to have bought some. So I don't know what the colours are going to look like on here, but all these natural colours. She sends all the fleeces off to the mill who prepare the yarn for her. And she was saying there's quite a lot of wastage, because I was saying, well, that's incredibly even colour. Are these not dyed? She said, no, they're just incredibly well sort of combed in and spun to be very, very even. Because of that, if there's much discrepancy in the colours within a fleece, it's quite a lot of wastage, so I think it's quite intensive. But I bought these two balls of yarn. That's not too bad as a representation on screen. It's a much richer colour than that. It's a very gold, it's got a reddish tinge to it, which looks very golden on screen. But this, see any better there. It's so lovely. It's definitely a DK weight. It's really light. It's really airy. But it's for alpaca. It's not very hairy. Having said that, there's a massive old guard hair there. It's not very hairy, so it might not bloom as much as some alpaca does, which means it's going to be really good for stitch definition. It's quite tightly spun, which I like. And the evenness of the colour is gorgeous. So I think this might become a really nice hat. Or some Princess Leia hair pieces, which I'll just keep. I may just sort of put a strap on them over there, and next time I go to a Return of the Jedi themed party, costume sorted. I don't think so. It's going to be a nice hat. So these are two 50 gram balls. So if you're interested in checking them out, they are www.overpriestercottfarm.co.uk. So it's overpriestercottfarm.co.uk, and Over Priestercott is spelt like that. I'll put links somewhere. I'm not very good at doing show notes recently, but I'll put links somewhere. And hopefully you can go on. It's quite a basic website, but they do have links to the stuff that they sell in their shop. One of the things we were talking about, I'd said, oh, I'm wearing alpaca now. She said, oh, that's very nice. Did you buy that in Peru? I said, no, I knitted it. And she was quite astonished. I was wearing my Perplexa scarf, for anyone who knows that pattern. It's all the zigzaggy diamonds in it. And so she made all the right noises over my scarf, and I made all the right noises over her yarn. And what's lovely about buying from a proper indie producer like she is, I know the name of the animal this came from. Because of its reddish tinge, which in fairness isn't showing up on screen very well, but it does have a reddish hue, the animal is called Ruby. Her name is Ruby, so I now know that I've got a hat made by Ruby's alpaca yarn. How lovely is that? A couple of stalls down, there was a chap who was selling some handmade pottery items. It's a proper local craft fair. Got hair on my nose now. And some of the things were absolutely gorgeous. He made these beautiful handmade Christmas baubles. They're quite big, but really, really striking designs on them. And I got talking to him because he did have, as part of his selection, some yarn bowls with a little slit down the side for sort of keeping your yarn running through. I said, would you mind me taking some pictures? So here's a few pictures of the yarn bowls. You can see the cutout, that slit goes all the way from the top, so you don't have to thread your yarn through and keep it in the bowl forever. You can just sort of run it in and out as you see fit. And they're brilliant for stopping your yarn from picking up lint from carpet, stopping it from running under your chair, You know all this. I don't have one and I've never used one before, but I very much do see the value of them. I think they'd be very useful indeed. Now, this gentleman is called Dom, and his company is Dom's Pottery. That's very logical. And I did ask him if I could take the photographs to show on the podcast, and he said he'd be delighted for me to do so. So I really hope that you like his stuff. Here's his card, www.domspottery.com. That takes you straight to his Etsy store. Is that focusing? I think it might need a little bit of help. I don't know. That takes you straight to his Etsy store, where he's got all sorts of things. The things that are featured on the card here, they're markers for your garden, for putting next to different plants. I think they've all got different... Oh, yeah, they have. They do say things on them. They say basil, rosemary. So they've all got little herbs names on them, so you can put them next to the herbs so you know what's what. Nice little idea. He's got loads of stuff. Do head over. He's based in North Hill in Launceston, which is where we were, and that's his web address, as I said, and you can also find him at domspottery@gmail.com, domspottery@gmail.com. And I really hope that somebody likes it, because I would get such a kick out of knowing that me talking about his stuff on here has prompted somebody out there to say, do you know what, that stuff's amazing, I really, really like it. Let me show you some of the other things I've got on here from Dom. So here's one of the yarn, here's one of the yarn bowls. Is that gonna work? Just waiting for the technology to catch up with me, ladies and gentlemen. Here you go, and they're so distinctive. There you go, that's the light. And you can see that curled slit in the front there. I really like that. And then we've got not just the yarn, but they've also got little stars cut out. It's hard to see on that one. But he does some beautiful mugs with these wonderful, is that gonna adjust for you? Yeah, there you go. These wonderful designs on them. Very, very much the homemade variety. But there's other stuff which looks much more polished. I love this butter dish. Yeah, that's just gorgeous. Wait for that to adjust. Likewise. Is that gonna work? There you go. Really, really nice. So that's Dom and Dom's Pottery. And it was really nice chatting to him. So Dom, if you ever see this, hello, and nice, thanks for the chat. So we had an amazing time, and the banquet itself was gorgeous. Had a most fantastic, delicious steak dinner, and this devastatingly gorgeous chocolate tart to finish with. It was one of the chocolatiest things I think I have ever, ever tasted in my life. And for anyone who knows me well, you will know that I have a criminally sweet tooth. I do love my sweets. I should say, if you see me playing with my lip, I'm a little bit worried about it. We were doing the filming this morning, as I've already said, and I had quite a lot of facial hair, quite thick stubble, and I know that I'm not really supposed to have the beard for the filming. They want sort of continuity, but it's too late. However, partway through, we had to do something that... I don't like the fakery of television. I like to keep things as real as possible. But we needed to be showing stuff that was supposed to have happened on two separate days, even though it was both happening today. So we just wanted to see a bit of progress of time. So Ben and I were asked if we could quickly go and change our clothes into something else. And I thought, well, it's unusual in this process for me to have any facial hair, so why don't I shave it off really quickly? And rather than shave, I just got the hair trimmers, I got some hair clippers, and I thought, well, I'll just trim it all off like that. And as I went to trim off my moustache, those clipper blades, I just got the wrong angle, and it went straight into my top lip, and I bled. So I'm not gonna show you. A little line of cuts in there, which I really rather sore. So we really had to hurry up stopping the blood, because we had to get back on camera, we're running out of time. So, act in haste, repent at leisure. There's an answer for that. So that's why I may be sort of dabbing at my lips. really very painful. The things we have to do for our art. Hmm? That was our trip there. This weekend, just gone, I went up to my sister's house on Sunday. Excuse me. My dad and my stepmother were there. My mum and her partner, Ron, and my sister and her new husband, alert, coming onto that story in a moment, and various members of his family, my niece and nephew and my great-niece were there. My niece Jenny wasn't there. She was in Amsterdam, having a wonderful time, no doubt. And she's working so hard at the moment. She's in her second year of midwifery training, and apparently she's delivered 11 babies all by herself already. So she's loving what she's doing. But it was my great-niece's third birthday, and so we all gathered there for that. And Ben had said to my mum, outside your house, you've got a lot of conker trees, haven't you? Horse chestnut trees. She said, yes. He said, I think we should have a conker tournament. So my mum, always mad and always up for something, she went out gathering a massive, great big shopping bag full of conkers, there must have been about 200, and brought them along. What she hadn't brought was a skewer or anything to poke the holes in so that we could play conkers. Now, I don't know if our North American friends, Canada or the US, I don't know if you would have a concept of conkers. A conker is the, you may not even know the word, a conker is the kind of the seed that's inside the horse chestnut pods, those sort of green spiky things that hang off a horse chestnut plant. And inside it's got this brown sort of maroon, sort of like, well, it's chestnut colour. They are horse chestnuts after all, duh. And you put a hole through them and you tie a shoelace on, and then you hold one out and someone else has one and you take it in turns hitting the other person's dangling conker with your strong conker until one of them smashes or cracks. And then the one that is the victor is a one-er. And if it kills two conkers, it's a two-er. Can you see how this is working? You may already know this, so this is like really, really conker 101. But I haven't played conkers since I was, well, probably for about 30 years. And I think everyone saw the bag of conkers and was like, conkers. I have to say, there were lots of people there that I didn't know, so I didn't know how to judge their senses of humour, because I haven't met a lot of Julius's side of the family yet, because my sister and he are only just married. So this was a chance to sort of gauge people's level of engagement and commitment to crazy. My family, we all go mad. Other people might think of us as a bit bonkers and might not want to join in. But I think people were a little bit sort of dismissive of the conkers when they saw them in the bag. However, when the drill came out, that's right, ladies and gents, no screwing a skewer through it or anything like that. We got a massive, great big Makita out. One, two, that's how you get your holes in your conkers. And then we were tying bits of string on. We got this conker tournament going in the garden and everyone was involved. People were bruising themselves. It's a dangerous game. I'd forgotten how much sort of jeopardy there is in conkers. Because if you've got your conker here and the string coming from your thumb and you hit like that, sort of you let go of the conker, it goes over. If it doesn't strike your opponent's conker, it's just going to keep going on its string. And more often than not, the force you put into it is going to translate into that conker travelling round and smacking you on your own wrist. People were going away from that tournament with great big red welts down the insides of their wrists. It's no wonder it got banned at my school. Having said that, we all had so much fun. I think conker should be brought back, and I think it should be allowed. I think people should do it rather than sitting on their backsides playing computer games on their iPads all day. I think we should all get out, getting climbing trees, looking for conkers, playing them. Manual dexterity, there's aim, there's all sorts of skills involved with it. There's the element of competition, there's feelings of victory, it's all brilliant, and I think everyone in life can learn a lot from playing conkers. There was one of the chaps, Julius's daughter's partner, a chap called Reese, who I hadn't met before, probably gave Ben a run for his money in terms of competitiveness. I thought my husband was the most competitive man on the planet. He's got some stiff competition in his competitiveness from Reese. The two of them were the last ones standing. Get more Conkers. It was hilarious. But the reason I'm telling this story is because this is the first time I've seen my sister since 3 weeks ago when she got married. Oh my goodness. Their wedding photographs are ridiculous. I can't remember if I've told you this already, but they got married at sunset in the Grand Canyon, in the Valley of Fire, standing on these bright orange rocks, surrounded by what looked like a Martian landscape. It was like setting foot on a backdrop for an old Star Trek episode, you know, the original series. It was quite extraordinary. They'd done the whole of Route 66 on their Harley Davidson motorbikes, encompassing a trip up to Toronto and back, and then getting on board with doing the Route 66 as far as take a detour down to go to Vegas, from where they got picked up in a limo out to the Grand Canyon at sunset, took these amazing photographs, got married, just the two of them, then the celebrant and her husband, who was their photographer and witness, just this two-person band who do these packages of the limo and the photography and the wedding itself. Just amazing. And so we wanted to look through all their photographs and do the gun. I think there are probably about 800 pictures from their 3 weeks away, but I couldn't get enough. I wasn't there at the wedding, and it made me very sad, and it was very moving watching the little clip of the video, which, I mean, it took them about 7 minutes to do the actual ceremony, with the camera just on them. You couldn't see the celebrant, she was off camera. But it was very moving because Sam, my sister, we're really close, and it upset me quite a lot not to be able to be there, although I knew that they were having the trip of a lifetime and the wedding of their dreams. So of course I didn't begrudge them that, but selfishly I felt I should have been there. She was at mine and played a big part in mine. For anyone who's seen our gay wedding, my sister was one of the MCs along with Ben's brother Edward. And actually what I did enjoy learning was when I said to her afterwards, I said, where did you get the corset that you're wearing? She said, oh, it's the one that I wore at your wedding. So she was wearing her corset at mine and hers, and that at least made me feel that I was there in some sort of way. But it was just jaw-droppingly beautiful, some of the pictures. I'm going to ask her if she wouldn't mind me sharing some pictures with you, because I think you deserve to see them. Well, here they are, if she says yes. So, on to community. As I said, I haven't had a great deal of opportunity to be very active in my group. I've been trying to pop in and read stuff, and I've been trying to answer things where I can. I don't like leaving things too long, and I do apologise. I feel really, really bad that I haven't had the chance to properly go in there and spend time. Haven't done much at all. However, I have been looking at some things, and one thing made me very, very happy. It's from Chris in Australia, who is Dirty Dog on Ravelry, and he posted, in the problems with double knitting thread, but it's not a problem with double knitting at all. And about a week ago, he posted this. I'll read it in its entirety. Gosh, that uplighting is a bit harsh, isn't it? He says, I can't find any problems with DK knitting at all. It's easy. My hands just know where the colours are supposed to go. I knit with both hands, as do I. A few years ago, I knew of a woman who mentioned about DK knit, and she hated it because she couldn't watch TV or have people or pets around her as she gets muddled with the yarns. I watch TV all the time. My friends get into a trance as I knit around and listen to their babbling stories. I even watch Sockmatician's podcast and never get muddled, ever. How am I going to go back to single knitting ever again? And I guess the only problem now, as I look other people's, and his own one yarn projects, I think to myself, yawn, boring. This is the knitting I've been craving my whole life, and it surprises me all the time as I look at the project. The colours, shapes are amazing. And I don't know, Chris, whether you've done double knitting before or whether you're very recent. Maybe you've been brought to it from watching this podcast, I don't know. But I just love the fact that you all know how evangelical I am about DK. To hear somebody like Chris saying that he doesn't want to go back to one yarn knitting, or single face as I call it. I so rarely do anything without two yarns now. It feels like I'm only knitting half a thing. Obviously, it means that my projects grow more slowly, and I take more time over them, particularly a scarf or a shawl, which is a big thing. But I love it. Chris, I absolutely love it. So Chris, for you, for that post, you are this week's proud recipient of one of Joyce's fabulous Sockmatician stitch markers. For those of you who don't know, Joyce is AussieYarning.etsy.com, and she made these wonderful little stitch markers for my podcast there that have a Sockmatician logo on one side, and on the other side it says, "Stuff for the boys!" So Chris, the ridiculousness is, you're in Australia, and now I'm going to send you one of these from England to Australia, having already had it sent from Australia by Joyce to me here. So it's going to be not exactly carbon neutral, and have done a lot of miles. So again, Joyce, thank you so much. Everyone check out Joyce. She's Joyce Fisher. She's Zoe Knit Girl on Ravelry. Aussie Yarning is her Ravelry group. And so yeah, that's it. Thank you again. I love these. There's still a few to give away. I'm holding on to some for myself. Ha ha! Because I can, because they're mine. So Chris, send me a PM with your postal address in it, and one of those will be winging its way to you. And I hope that you continue loving DK as much as you do now, and as much as I do, because for me, the obsession ain't going anywhere anytime soon. In terms of other community-based stuff, I'm not entirely sure I've got a great deal to share with you, apart from obviously the alpaca farm and the yarn thing. So if anyone's got any companies or any products and stuff that they feel like I could feature, particularly if it's a kind of stuff for the boys sort of thing, stuff that is less flouncy and frilly and pink and sparkly, then do let me know, and I'll happily feature it here on the podcast. As I said earlier, I just love the idea that people would see something on here and then go and buy it from somebody else and make them a little bit of money. That would make me incredibly happy. I'm just trying to think. I really should have planned this a bit better. In terms of other community stuff, there are some podcasts, of course, that I do watch a lot. There are other podcasts which I'm aware of and dip into from time to time, and I feel really, really guilty because they're lovely. And there's one that I want to mention. I haven't watched many. It's Maureen, Victorian Studio. I've watched a couple of your episodes so far, and I desperately want to spend time getting fully into them. So if anybody else wants to go to Victorian Studio podcast, please check out Maureen. I know she's a watcher of this one, and she's in my group as well. We've had some nice chit-chats online. I really enjoyed Maureen's podcast, and I haven't had a chance to go into it fully, so I do plan to do it. I'm just not sure when. I'm a little bit behind on everything. I haven't seen Josh Brown, Auricular 82. I haven't seen your latest Dairyland Knits episode either. I've downloaded it, so I've got some train time tomorrow. And because I've downloaded it onto my iPad already, I think I should probably tuck into that one tomorrow. And I'm well behind on Josh Ricks, I'm afraid. Sorry, Sort of a Knitter. I'm not up to date on yours. And already falling behind on the Bakery Bears as well. Oh, there's just not enough hours in my day. But if any of you are watching this one and you don't know any of the ones I've just mentioned, go check them out, because I love them. Don't forget, everybody, now I know there's a lot of crossover between this podcast and Dan and Kay. Hello, Dan. Hello, Kay. Don't forget, there's going to be a special edition coming up on their podcast of their quiz show, Knit or Forfeit, featuring me challenging Dan to a quiz-off. This is a match made in heaven for me. I love the Bakery Bears podcast. I love Dan and Kay. They are not just brilliant podcasters, they are brilliant people. And I'm incredibly fond of both of them. And I'm also incredibly fond of quizzes. Ben is also a massive quizzer and comes from a family of quizzers. His mum and dad, Richard and Noel, dad and mum, Richard and Noel, often in the village they live in, it's a town of Thaxted in North Essex, they often have quizzes held at the local tennis club or the local cricket club. And it's a big, big deal. And we went to one a couple of weeks ago. There were supposed to be 8 of us on our team, but because of a couple of no-shows, we were only 5. And we came second. Now, we're not too upset about that, because I did some maths. And I looked at the winning team. Now, they had about 6 points more than us. They also had 8 people on their team. So I did the maths, and I divided their score by 8 and got an average of points per person. I divided our score by 5 and got our average points per person, which was about 3 points per person higher than their average, which means, on balance, surely James Bartley, you will agree with me on this one, that the maths would suggest that therefore we won. We got more points per person than they did. So I call that a win, even though we only came second. And we didn't win the raffle either. Boo. And I'm also an episode behind with yours as well, James. So James of Dancing Geek podcast, if anyone is watching this and hasn't seen him, check him out. That's my community stuff. Let's move on to some more stash enhancement. You've already seen this, right? This is fun. Today, actually, do you know what? I'm not going to go on to what came through the post today just yet. I'm going to go on to something that I picked up at my mum, or from my mum, the other day. Now, I've mentioned this before. My auntie Sheila, when I sang at my cousin Catherine's wedding, was talking about this particular yarn, and I couldn't picture it. She was talking about this sort of textured yarn that she makes scarves out of, and one pack comes, and it's really cheap, and it comes with everything apart from the needles and all the instructions to make this scarf. You can knit it up in a couple of hours. I had no idea what I was expecting. Then my mum went to her house and visited her, and she gave my mum, to give to me, a pack of this yarn. And I promptly left it at my mum's house. So that's the bit you know so far. I've now got it. It's outrageous. I've never seen anything like it. I'm not entirely sure it's yarn at all. I'm sure it's the stuff that you put around the fringe and the tassels and the pom-poms around lampshades. It's ridiculous. You may have come across it before. I never have. Look at that madness. It just makes me laugh. It's on one level brilliant and on another utterly revolting. Look, it's this like this weird net mesh, which is really quite extravagant if you pull it out. There you go, look, you see that? And on one side of it, it's got these crazy little pom-poms. And it goes through various different colours, as you can see. This one's all creams and browns. It's Crilando, seems to be the name of the company. It comes, Crilando, and it comes in this pack of 4 bags. If you see the nice lady on the front, she's very, very happily modelling her scarf, which doesn't look so much like a scarf as though she's just got these 4 balls gone like that for the pictures. I genuinely don't know what to think. The first thing I think is that Auntie Sheila, thank you so much. It was very, very generous of you to think of me and to pop one of these over to my mum, especially for me. The next thing I think is, I just don't know what I'm going to do with it. It's got the instructions here for a scarf or a bag. You can apparently make a bag out of it as well. I'm not sure. It's all in garter stitch, knit both right side and wrong side. I don't know that you could make a bag out of that very usefully, because stuff would either fall through it or would just get caught in it all the time. So I think a scarf is probably the easiest thing to do, and it does say here that the scarf would be garter stitch as well. Open the yarn. Row one, open the yarn. To cast on stitches in the first row, insert needles into each mesh opening on the edge without pom-poms, inserting from front to back, and work 12 loops into the needle. It says open the yarn. Does that mean pull it apart, like that? I'm not sure. I'll investigate. I will make it. I am going to make this scarf as a thank you. It's balmy. It's absolutely bonkers. So that's my Crelando. There you go. Crelando pom-pom yarn. And it's 100% polyester. So it's all brilliant stuff. And it says here to 7 to 9 millimeter needles. So it's gonna work out very quickly, I think. Oh, I think maybe you don't, yeah, maybe you just knit into the holes along the opposite edge. So you're knitting and actually sort of making a mesh rather than a mess, a mesh with pom-poms going up it rather than actually using it twisted up as a yarn. I think maybe that's what it means. I'll experiment and I shall let you know the fruits of my labors. Now today, moving on from that, I received through the post from John Arbonne, J. Arbonne Yarns. I can't remember what their website is. Let me just see. jarbonne.com. They are the purveyors of Knit by Numbers, the 100% Merino DK weight yarn, which comes in, I think it's 85 different colours. It's the one that I knitted the Piano number 1 scarf, with the grey and the turquoise. I really love working with their stuff, and you've seen scarves that I've been knitting for my nieces for Christmas. The brioche cable, the two colour brioche cable scarf, the purple and blue, and the scarf with one of the skull and crossbones, more about that in a moment. But I also have a nephew, and I didn't feel that it was particularly fair to give the girls a hand-knitted scarf and then just buy something for my nephew. That's not right. So I wanted to come up with a design that would suit him, and I think in my head, it's planned, I've charted it. In my head, it works very well for him. But, sorry, I'm just tapping the screen because I've gone a bit low battery. So if I do have to stop and start again, you'll know why. In my head, he will love it. And let's just hope he does. But I wanted to get some John Arbonne Knit by Numbers because it's brilliant. It's so squishy and soft and really, really warm and lovely. And I asked my sister to find out what his two favourite colours were. And he said green and purple. So he's getting a green and purple scarf. And these arrived today. And they are just gorgeous. I wonder if the colours will come up on screen. Look how saturated these are. They are just lovely. Do you know what? I don't want to take the risk that I'm going to lose you, so I think I'm going to plug the phone in right now. Stay there. I'm back. The phone is now plugged in and should be charging. So, these are absolutely just the most lovely colours, and I think they're quite eccentric together, but I really, really love them. I've said this before, quite recently, that I'm getting more and more switched on by colour. And these colours, I just think, are gorgeous. This purple is so beautifully saturated and so, so gorgeous. This one is number KBN 25. KBN just stands for Knit by Numbers, and it's number 25. It's got its batch number on there, and it's Knit by Numbers. They're 100% Merino double knit. Really, really lovely. And the green, to showcase it on its own, is number 68, KBN 68, which you can see just there. It's so gorgeous. It makes such a bouncy, bouncy fabric. And I absolutely love them. So this should be enough for Lewis's scarf, and I will be able to show you more about that When I cast it on. Which is going to be soon, because it's his Christmas present, and we're already approaching November, and it's double knitting, so it's going to take a little while. So that's that. I'm so, so looking forward to getting stuck into that. It's going to be a bit tech geekery and a bit knit geekery, and I've already planned it all out, I've already charted it all out, so now I just need to cake up these yarns and then cast on and start knitting. Shouldn't be that tricky to knit. I think it's going to be a nice simple one. There's not anything particularly crazy going on, it's just a nice design, and I'm really happy with how it looks on paper. How it'll translate to green and purple actual stitches, I don't know, but I can't wait. So let's move on. Let's move on to whips. I have actually done some knitting. You'll be pleased to know I have got back into my knitting since I last saw you. I have had a couple of evenings where I've been knitting in front of the telly, and it's not been podcast watching time because I'm sharing it with Ben, and our time together at the moment is kind of... Well, I say our time together is precious. Our time together not working together is precious. One of the problems with working with your partner is you don't get a chance to close the door on the project at the end of an evening. Most people, they go home, they can whinge to their loved ones about that dreadful colleague who's really pissing them off. I don't get to do that because that dreadful colleague who's really pissing me off is my husband. I can't tell him. He feels exactly the same way about me, don't worry. But I have gone back into some knitting. So first of all, I've got some yarn trapped under something. Oh, I've disappeared completely out of shot, sorry about that. Now, I'm okay with this being mine. I was really hoping that my poolie socks would be donated, or be ripped out and donated to Kay Jones should she have lost her Knit and Forfeit episode with Dan. Unfortunately, Dan, man, you let me down. Kay won, and brilliantly so. And so she didn't have to perform her forfeit, which is knitting with the pooliest yarn that Dan could find for her. So my poolie socks had been on pause. I'd just started on the heel flap of the first one. I'd left them being, so there was no point knitting them in case I'm going to rip them out and send the yarn off to Kay. But here they are. Here we are. The lighting in here is so awful for showing knitting. I'll try and do my best. So it doesn't look like they're too poolie, really, until you turn it over and you see, look at that. It was a bit like Harry Potter. So I was, until yesterday, when I went back to these, I was just on the heel flap, but if I can get these on my hand in a way that can show you what I've done. I've turned the heel, and I started the gusset, which was here. So I finished off the heel flap and turned the heel, and then I've knitted all of that. That was done last night watching the television. And again, the pooling is, it seems to have really settled. My tension is obviously really settled, because that's very, very evenly diagonal across there and sort of wrapping itself round. That black stripe is quite pronounced. I don't mind it. A lot of people have been talking in my group on Ravelry about the pooling, and some people saying it's just yarn doing its thing. Some people say it creates quite a striking effect, and people like the pooling. Sometimes it can really not work. I mean, this is just a sock, you know. This is kind of a bit of stash yarn that I've had for ages. I don't really tend to buy yarn like this anymore. When I first got into knitting, I'd see things on the ball and just go, oh, that's really lovely, without really paying much attention to how it was going to look knitted up. And because I like doing stuff with a lot of colourwork patterning, particularly in the DK stuff that I do, these sorts of yarns are really kind of useless to me, because something like that would just break any other colour we were using, it would just break up those patterns too much. And even if I were using a really textured pattern, something with lots of cables or anything, I think that might... it might get in the way and break up the line of what it is you're trying to create. However, for a bit of mindless telly knitting, I have to say, I really don't mind. Really don't mind a very, very plain vanilla sock. And I'm getting to the stage now where I'm competent enough to not really need to be looking at what I'm doing. So having said that, I'm going to mess it all up now. So I'm quite able to sit and knit and watch television. I haven't gone down the road of knitting and reading anytime soon because I think I'd need a third hand for that. But it is kind of fun to just get going. I'm faster when I do look, obviously. Knit, but it's just so lovely to have something where I don't have to think at all. Don't get me wrong, I really enjoy complicated knitting patterns, but I've knitted a lot of stuff recently that's quite fiddly, and it's just nice to be able to switch your brain off once in a while. You all know what I'm talking about. So there are my poolie socks, getting more and more work done on them, even as we podcast together. How amazing is that? This is just, I don't know what this yarn is. It's an old thing I've had. I think it might be fibre spades. I don't know what the specific colourway is or anything like that. As you can see, I'm a magic looper. As you can see, I'm a right-handed knitter, so English style, but I'm not a thrower. I'm a flicker. I'm a finger flicker, and all the work is done with that finger. People's techniques in knitting fascinate me, as you all know. So that's that. This was just a... My preferred rib for a vanilla sock is not 2x2 rib, and it's not 1x1, it's 2x1 rib. I think if you have 2x2, the purl ditches are really, really wide. I like the look of 2x1. I think you get the stretch, you get the structure of it without having massive, great big canyons in the purl stitches. This happens to be a 72 stitch sock. Most of my socks that I make for myself are an 80 stitch sock on 2mm needles, but this is 72 on, I think it's 2.5 actually, not even 2.25. Oh no, it is 2.25. So, and I'm knitting a little bit more loosely these days than I tend to, so I might be coming down in number from my normal 80 stitch sock. Although I do like an 80 stitch sock, it makes the math so much easier. Obviously, 80 is not divisible by 3, so for 2x2 rib, I'll cast on 78 stitches and then make 2 more stitches on my first round after the ribbing. 78, that's right, isn't it? Because 81. Yeah, 78. So I normally cast on 78 and then make 2 more stitches. But then you've got 80, 80, 80, then the heel flap's on 40, and then the toe is on 20. It's just so much easier. This is 72, so I have to work a little bit harder, but I'm really enjoying the mindlessness of it. It's quite rough, not very soft yarn. They're fun to knit. So this will up my allocation of hand-knitted socks, and I can one day maybe get to the stage where I don't need to actually wear any bought socks anymore. I'd quite like that. My friend Sam, who knits socks all the time, knits all of his own socks, doesn't even own any store-bought socks anymore, and for him it's all about yarns that will do things like this. He never deviates from his vanilla recipe, and never gets bored doing the same sock time again, because he's always working with some fabulous yarn that makes him happy and keeps it fresh for him. So that I think is brilliant. My other whip is the scarf. Now this is the scarf that I'm knitting for my niece Becky, who has always been into zombies and a bit gothic and a bit emo and stuff. So she likes things a little. She's a bit of a tomboy as well. She likes things a bit unorthodox. You've seen this before, but I have done quite a lot more work on it. This is my scarf here. It's a scarf with scare in it because it's got skull and crossbones motif. It's double knitted, and the fun aspect is that these skull and crossbones, the eyes are double yarn overs, so they are actually, you can't see, but they are holes all the way through. I love that. Actually, you can probably see better on that bad boy there. Can you see? There you go, you can see all the way through the knitting. And what's fun about this scarf, more than anything else, is the addition of the wiggly stripe down the middle. Now, for anyone who hasn't seen this scarf before, it's actually brioche. The outsides are double knitted, but you can see the texture of this middle stripe. It's two colour brioche. You can see all the little yarn over shawls that every stitch has. and on the back you get the reverse effect with the different colours. I love doing two colour brioche, and I love the fact more than anything that you can get so quickly and easily from double knitting into brioche and back again. Now, for those of you who don't already know this, and for my dad who won't care, who doesn't knit, so I knit with the yarn in both hands when I do double knitting, and I wanted to find a way of doing brioche knitting that could do both passes. Brioche usually is done with two passes per row, one with one colour, then you slip the stitches back, and then you go on the other colour and doing the alternate stitches, making sure everyone gets worked. It's perfectly possible to do both in one go, both yarns together, and it works out with exactly the same structure as normal two colour brioche, and it's what I call the one pass two colour brioche. It actually takes longer to say it than it does to do it. But now, I've talked about this before, but the exciting thing for me was when I realised that the way of doing it truly, because there was a way out there called double Dutch, which doesn't actually give you quite the same structure, but the way of doing it is so closely related to the way I do double knitting anyway, that it became clear to me that two colour brioche is a form of double knitting. It absolutely is. And if you think about it, most people who do two colour brioche will slip every other stitch and work every other stitch with one colour, and then work the in-between stitches and slip all the other stitches with the second colour. Now, some people work their double knitting exactly the same way, by slipping a stitch and working it, slipping a stitch and working it, slipping a stitch and working it, and then with the other pass, working a stitch and slipping it, working a stitch and slipping the next one. So there's no difference. There's absolutely no difference. It's just what you do with the yarns. The mechanics of how I do it are so similar. I would defy anyone who's a non-knitter to be able to tell the difference as I'm working across a row. Do you know what? I'm going to demonstrate. I don't know how this is going to work on camera. I don't know how we're going to get there. But let me set up for double knitting. So this is how I do my double knitting. I have my pearl colour in my left hand and my knit colour in this hand. Actually, before I do that, I need to just set up the first two stitches before I can set up my yarns properly, because I'm working what's called the slip stitch edging, which means that you have to do a couple of little bits of shenanigans at the beginning of the row just to get going, and that keeps everything neat and tidy down the edges. Any of you experienced double knitters will know exactly what I'm talking about. Anyone else, you don't need to worry about it. So I've got one yarn in each hand. I knit. Let me come really, really close so you can see. I'm going to knit with that colour, bring my yarns forward, purl with that colour, take my yarns to the back, okay? Knit with that colour, yarns forward, purl with that colour, yarns to the back. Knit with that colour, and I'm even going to come around to the other side of the camera so you can see my eye view. So I can't actually see whether this is on in shot or not. I think we're in shot there. So I'm going to knit with the black, bring the yarns forward, and purl with the green, yarns to the back. That's how I do my double knitting. I've just got a few more to do to get to the point where I'm going to transition into brioche. So it really is knit one, move the yarns, purl one, move the yarns back. That's all you do all the way across. And you got a sense, I guess, of how the flow of that worked. So I'm nearly at the point where I transition to the brioche stripe down the middle. Nearly there, knit one, purl one, knit one, purl one, knit one. I'm sorry about this. I didn't think this through. It's taking a little bit longer than I expected it to. But it's quite a nice demonstration of the sort of speed and flow that you can build up. So here we go. I've got one more pair of double knitting stitches before I go into the brioche. So here I come, back close to the camera again. So I'm going to knit, this is my last pair of double knitting. I'm going to knit as normal, bring the yarns forward, purl as normal, take the yarns to the back. Now to set up for the two colour brioche, all I do is I take this purl yarn and wrap it over the top of my needle. Then I go in to knit the purl with its yarn over. There's two stitches together there because this is now brioche. I go in underneath that back yarn and knit it, bring the yarns to the front, and go into purl with the yarn over together. And then instead of taking the yarns to the back through the needles, I just take them over the side. It's hard to see in that angle. So instead of going between the needles there, I take the yarns over the right needle, and then I'm ready to knit again. So the mechanics of it look almost exactly the same as what I'm doing for the double knitting. This is all brioche now, knit and purl, and one more set of brioche stitches before taking that one to the back and continuing knit, forward, purl, back. So that is it. I mean, the mechanics hardly change at all. And that was a bit of an epiphany for me, and that was where the idea for this scarf came from, to be able to transition really seamlessly from one to the other. You get such a great texture. The waving is done with increases and decreases either side. It's just four columns of double brioche, two colour brioche pairs. So there we are. That's the scarf. And on the other side, you get the opposite colours. Obviously, that's a green skull, and it's a black one counterpart on the back. I'm really looking forward to getting this finished. I don't know quite how long it needs to be. Probably, I suspect, twice as long as it is at the moment. I've done what? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 skulls. I think I had done just under 6 the last time you saw this. So I've come back to it and had a good few sessions on it, and I've done 2 more skulls, and really thoroughly enjoying it. The little bit of lace that makes the eyes is really fun. There's just a couple of decreases and then those double yarn overs to make the eye holes. Other than that, it's just straightforward stuff. It's great fun. Really, really enjoying it. So those are my whips, with a little bit of demonstration there. I mean, that's you know, top knowledge there you've just had shared with you. And the kind of stuff, if I'd put that in a crafty class, I could be a millionaire. I'm just, you know, giving it away. You guys, honestly, you don't know you're born. I have an FO. It's been a long time since I've had an FO to share. You can probably guess what it is. It's the Peano number 2 scarf. Now, it is off the needles, it is all darned in. It's still got its little stitch marker, so 3 weeks ago, the stitch marker was there, and I've knitted to the end of the scarf there. So now we can do the ceremonial removing of the stitch marker. This is now completely a finished object. I love it. I really, really like it. I haven't worn it yet. I haven't worn it out and about, but it's just so, oh God, it's so bright, and it's so geometric, and it's so mathematical, and it's so geeky, and it's so double knitty, and it's so, oh. It's gonna be, excuse me, my lip is bothering me, there's something stuck to it. There we go, it's the hair. So it's going to be a very, very fun scarf. It's tall. It's really, really long. Let me fold it in half and I can show you how. Here I am standing up on the floor. Both ends are now touching the floor and it comes up to sort of my rib cage. So it's way, way taller than I am. It's probably at least 7 feet long, maybe a little bit more than that. it will happily go into, what do you call that, the Parisian knot or something like that, where you pull it through, or you can wrap it around several times. I am going to be wearing this scarf out and about very soon because it's just so scrummy-licious. It feels so nice. It's to recap for those who don't know, the yarn is, the black is Malabrigo sock yarn and the green is Deeply Wicked from easyknits.co.uk from John Dunballum. It's called Key Lime. The pattern is the second one in the series of my Peano scarves, which is just over there. Bear with me. Here's the first one. So you can see this is a much sort of bigger, less complex version of the same pattern. So that's how the two of them look side by side. That's how they relate to each other, which I'm not sure I've actually seen them together before. And I love them very, very much. And this is also the John Arbonne Knit by Numbers, the same as these. So that's the Peano number two. And the maths, if you remember, it's all about the Giuseppe Peano space-filling curve. Just look it up on Wikipedia, space-filling curve, and you'll find all about Giuseppe Peano and his wonderful fractal, which I'm turning into this series of scarves. There is a third one to come. Do you know what? It's the evening. I'm going to carry on wearing it. There is a third one to come. It's very, very different. You might think that if that's the simpler version, this is a more complex version, that the next one would be just a denser version. It wouldn't work that way. I could do that in a blanket, but this is already just one stitch wide. The joy of this, and I have done it, is the line that starts here at the bottom end wiggles up and down and through and does all its thing and covers the entire scarf continuously without a break or without missing any bits until it gets back to, on this side, the opposite end. So there's the beginning of the line in that corner and there's the end of the line in that corner. And just to prove it, and just to show that I hadn't made, or to prove to myself that I hadn't made any errors with it, once I'd finished it and laid it out, before I bound off, I made sure I followed the black line throughout the entire scarf. It drove me mad. I had to stop a few times and start again because I got lost. I was like, did I make a mistake? Or is there a mistake in the scarf? Thankfully, I had made a mistake. I'd gone the wrong way and sort of lost concentration. But actually, it does work. It's a repeating pattern, but there's one single line, which is continuous. That makes me so happy. But the third one in the series, I haven't actually talked about it yet, and I'm not prepared to do it yet. It's all planned in here. I know exactly what it's going to be. I haven't quite worked out the mechanics yet, so I don't know whether what I envisage will work properly in the real world, but let's just say it's going to be a bit of a different beast. Based on the same pattern, and actually going back to a simpler version of the pattern like this, probably this much complexity in the actual pattern itself, but in terms of how you execute it, it's not going to be the same at all. Just think. That's all I've got to say on the matter at the moment. You're going to have to tune in to future episodes to find out about Peano number three. I am really, really pleased. I'm really looking forward to it. But there's still so much to do. I've really got to make a start on Lewis's scarf. I've got to make a start on this. Actually, I'm wondering, when I was up at my sister's, dust all over everything. When I was up at my sister's, oh, it hasn't transferred, nothing's come over here. Oh, actually, some photographs have transferred. You can see here's me and Ben in our Tudor costumes. Lots of fun. There's Ben full length, looking fabulous. That was in one of the more modern parts of the house. And there's my rather crazy doublet and hose, looking a little bit fab. But we went into the, here was the mad crew that we all were. Can you see there's, that's the grand hall all laid out for dinner. Everyone's costumes looked fantastic. We even had a couple of ladies in there, although the assembled guests were all men. Anne Boleyn and Catherine of Aragon, I believe, lurking in there somewhere. Just see. Looking fabulous. And even the King of Spain made an appearance there. We did have a fantastic time. Let me see if I've got any pictures of the actual house. What I was hoping to show you on here were some, oh gosh, you know, there's the great hall, big fireplace. I was hoping to be able to show you some photographs that we took with my sister. No, they haven't come through on my camera roll yet. They're still on this phone, but I may edit some in. Yeah, why don't I do that? These are the pictures that I took when I was visiting my sister. We wanted to get some really nice photographs of the Genesis shawl, because I am still working on writing that up. It is a bit of a PhD. there's a lot of it. But these are the photographs that we took to help me with the pattern. I haven't really looked through them all properly yet, but here's just a highlighted few. I'm really, really pleased with them. I think she looked great. You'd never think, would you, that this woman was a granny. She's doing all right. And when I do get the time to go back to writing it up, then that's definitely going to help me with getting the pattern out. I've got so much to work on at the moment. I've got this one needs to be written up, which shouldn't be too difficult because it's the same foundation as this one, which basically means that it's different charts and different numbers of stitches, but I can essentially use the same structure of the pattern for that, so that shouldn't take me too long. I need to get some photographs. I've got the brioche scarf to write up, the scarf to write up, and what will be the scarf of these, and I need to be working on piano number 3, so I'm a busy boy in terms of knitting, and I just don't have the time. Oh, I'm back on that old story again. I'm looking at the wrong dot. But I leave it with me. I will chip away at little bits and pieces here and there, and now I know I've got some, hopefully a little bit more free time knitting in the evenings, I can at least get some of the knit work done, and hopefully that will translate into some free time for pattern writing as well, because, oh, here's some other things I've completely forgotten, which I should have said earlier. The Christmas knit, the Sockmatician Christmas knit along, which is hashtag Sockmatician CKAL, KAL at the end there, is going in full swing. The discount that I had put on, I had a 50% discount on all patterns in my store with no limitations at all. It went down really well. Thank you to everybody who's purchased patterns from it. Sockmatician Sock Shop in the on Ravelry, or just search for me as Nathan Taylor or Sockmatician. It was really, really lovely to see how many people were buying multiple patterns from me. I'd love to think that all of you are going to put those objects into the Christmas knit along. Please do. It'd be nice to get a lot more people showing off their work in there. A few people are already, which is great. I'd love that to go on. It was, the discount was intended to be for the CAL, but I'm just very, very happy that people have used it as a way of getting some patterns, because even though I'm only getting 50% of the money, I think enough people have bought patterns more than they would otherwise have done to make it worth my while doing. So there's the mercenary business head of Nathan Taylor. So actually what I'm going to do, that promotion finished 2 days ago, which on the 17th of October, I'm going to extend it, I'm going to reactivate it. So anybody who wants to purchase any of my patterns, please put your stuff in the CAL, but I'm going to extend that until the end of this month. So until the 31st of October, you'll be able to get 50% off all of my patterns. Just, I can't remember what, I can't remember what the coupon code was. What useless, useless podcaster. Now, let me just log in so I can tell you. Just chat amongst yourselves for a moment. I will find this information for you so I can do a promotions. Here we go. And, Christmas Knit Along. So, ChristmasKnitAlong. Christmas Knit Along. So that'll entitle you to 50% off any and all of my patterns. There's one lady who will remain nameless who I know has bought, in four different emails, she's bought 14 of my patterns. That's nearly my entire catalogue. Either she just likes a bargain, which is entirely possible, or she really likes the idea of maybe she likes my work. Maybe she's seen some of my patterns and knows that she likes the way it's laid out or the finished products. Either way, I'm delighted. So thank you. If you bought 14 of my patterns, you know who you are. So that's that. Oh, I've still got my initiative for the Remember Cowl. I am going to be making a small donation to the British Legion, the sort of people who run the poppy appeals, because we're in the centenary years, and my Remember Cowl, which is the one with the poppies on it, is all about remembering our First World War heroes. And I did say that I would put £1 from every poppy cowl, every Remember Cowl that gets purchased between then and Armistice Day. Remembrance Day. Remembrance Sunday, 11th of November. To be honest, there haven't been very many people buying that particular cowl since I said that. It's quite a popular cowl. Lots of people have made it. There's quite a few projects on Ravelry. It's called Remember, so don't forget. There's only been 4 or 5 people have bought it since I announced this. So I will be making a donation. I'm still going to keep it running until the 11th of November. But please do pop in and purchase that, because £1 from every pattern is going to go straight to the British Legion. I may top it up a little bit. Because I think it's a worthy cause, and they're looking after people who have served their country. So, that's that. Other than that, pop all your stuff in the Christmas Knit Along. Chat to me. Please send me messages. Actually, do you know what? I'm not sure if there were any messages in my message group. Let's have a little look, shall we? Let's see. I haven't had a chance to pop in there for ages. Questions. No, there's no new questions in there, so please, there are ones that I've sort of answered in writing, but there's nothing new to discuss on the podcast. So pop in there, ask me anything you like. Join the group if you haven't done already. Join the Christmas Knit Along. Subscribe here. Subscribe to me on Instagram. I promise I'm going to be a bit more active now that I've shown you this. I can take photographs of it. I wanted to release it here first of all. And let's get that group really, really zinging. It's a very, very sociable place, and I enjoy hearing all of your thoughts. What I want is to see a little bit more of people chatting to each other. So far, it's mostly sort of two-way between me and you and you and me, but how about you and you and you and you and him and her and you know, all the rest of it. So let's get all that going, because there's some really lovely people in there that I enjoy getting to know a lot. And thank you very much for watching and taking the time out of your day to spend with this rather rambling podcast. It's coming up to an hour and a half now. I think it's time to stop. So, although this podcast is now a finished object, just remember, life is a work in progress. Just take it one stitch at a time.